So without further ado, Ivett, take the floor. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So, hi again. It's been quite a while since I've been in Belgrade. Last time it was in 2017. And since then, this is the last, next one. And this time I brought a talk about just different styles of programming. And I'm not sure how many of you have been to code retreats before. Hands up if you have been to a code retreat. I don't see much, but yeah, a few people. Okay, so for those of you who don't know what a code retreat is, a bunch of software engineers get together, have 45 minutes to implement a specific problem, and the goal is to do it in a different way than you usually do it, and then you delete your code and have another 45 minutes of the same five more times. So in the end, by the end of the day, you have implemented Game of Life six times. And why it's good? It's really good because every time you sit next to a different person, these are usually pair coding sessions, and every time you are learning something different, you are going to get surprised in a different way. I've been running code retreats as a facilitator for 10 years, which is a long time. And every other month, we had a code retreat. So I can safely say that I have seen more than 100 implementations of this one single problem that we look at code retreats, which is the game of life. So let's talk about this specific problem first so that you understand what we are trying to solve here in different ways. We have an infinite grid. On this infinite grid, we have cells. Each cell is either dead or alive. Here we have one alive cell. And then this grid gets regenerated after every cycle. And there are specific rules of how you get from one state to the next. And now I'm going to explain the rules for that. And I want you to just pay attention to that one middle square, because that is the one that is going to represent the rule that I'm about to say. So the first rule is if a cell is alone, it dies because it's lonely. Even if it dies if there is only one neighbor. If there are two neighbors, it's going to stay alive. And also, it's going to stay alive if there are three neighbors. So these are reasonable rules. The next one might seem strange for everyone, except for those who were living in Berlin. Because to have a new cell, you have to have three people. It's, by the way, called a throuple, three people in a couple. So that's what you need for a new cell. And then if there are more than three, then the cell dies again. Okay, so these are the very, very simple rules. And why it's interesting, because if you just run this on a large board for a long time, then it creates these really interesting animations. These are very simple rules. It can be very chaotic, but from this chaos, these kinds of patterns tend to emerge. And that's why it's interesting. Okay, but for us, it's interesting because we want to solve this in different ways and learn from that. So basically, this whole problem begs one question, which is what should be the data structure? And I guess a lot of you have a guess what data structure we are going to use for this. Of course, the matrix. And when we try to use the matrix, this is the simplest solution. Like, I think everyone who goes to code retreat for the first time, they usually start with a solution, something like this. You create a new world, which is going to be our next iteration. You iterate through all of the cells in that array. And then for each cell, you decide here should stay alive or not. And then you just set it dead or alive and push it onto the structure. That's it. That's the whole solution. Of course, you need to figure out who should stay alive, and that for that you need to count the neighbors. Very simple rules for counting the for what should stay alive. Like, if the count is 2 and the cell is alive, then it should be alive. Or if the count is 3, then regardless of whether or not the cell was alive, it should be alive. Very straightforward. And again, we have to count the neighbors, which easiest way to do it is by doing 2 floor cycles within each other. That's going to get all of the 9 cells in a 3x3. And then we just count. And of course, we need to subtract 1 for the middle cell in case it was alive, because we were lazy to add an if statement, one more if statement in that thing. Okay, so this is the boring solution. It's not that long, but it's actually going to be one of the longest solutions today. So, what can we do that is different? So, there is a lesser known sequel to the matrix, the function, and the idea is, what if our matrix or world would actually be a function? And this is where people start scratching their heads, unless they have been doing functional programming, because for functional programming people, this is quite obvious. But basically, my world is a function means that for each x and y coordinate pair, this function is going to return whether or not that cell is alive. And if you think about it, that's basically what an array does, right? Even an n by n Boolean array is going to be a function that returns true or false depending on the xy coordinates. It's just that we don't think about it as a function. But here, we are making this very explicit. And if it is a function, or word is a function, that means that our evolve that will turn the one iteration to the next is going to be a higher order function where we take a function and return a function. How do we do that? I'm going to get a couple of definitions out of the way so that it's not cluttering my code. We have code constants for dead and alive. We have this sum function, which is just a reduce. And I just monkey patched it onto the array prototype because I can't believe that this is not part of the array interface. And then I have this data, but instead of explaining this bunch of things, I'm just going to write it out. This is basically just the delta to each of the neighbors, right? So there are 8 neighbors, and I just listed that to get from x, y, you need to subtract 1 and 1, get x minus 1 and y minus 1 are the 2 neighbors to the top left, and so on. Okay? Very simple definitions. Once we have these definitions, we can start writing our evolved function. And as I said, it's getting a function, and it should be returning a function. So right out of the bat, here is my function, x, y, and it should return whether the cell is alive or not. That's also straightforward. So when should it return alive? It should return alive when the neighbor count is 2 and the cell was alive, or the neighbor count is 3. Okay, that's also fairly straightforward. But we need to figure out the neighbor count. Okay, how do we figure out the neighbor count? Well, we take the deltas, do a map, which will basically shift these deltas to the point that we are looking at, to the xy point that we are looking at. So now we have a list of all the neighbors of xy. And then we just do another map, which will, for each neighbor, it will return 0 or 1, depending on whether or not the cell is alive. And then we just do a sum. Okay. So this solution was surprising for me when I first saw it. And fair warning, it's an interesting solution, but it uses a lot of memory, and at least that it uses that lot of memory to run very, very slowly. What I'm saying is that's not a very efficient solution. But interestingly, did you notice that there wasn't a single for, while, or if statement in there? Like, no control structures. None at all. And I think that's something to be appreciated. Yes, there are maps, but those are not pure traditional control structures. And I really, yeah, it's just beautiful. That no ifs, no nothing. And basically, the iteration is also solved because you just repeatedly compose this function. It's a beautiful solution, I think. Okay, so it's mind-bending. I like it because it's mind-bending. I like it because it abstracts away the data structure. If you think about it, now you could write a word that is represented by a matrix in the backend, or you could write another world that is represented by a set of all the living cells, or you could write another world that is representing, well, it's not really representing, it's just a function that returns values. This kind of abstraction, I think it's very interesting to see. But what I don't like is the next sequel. No, I don't mean that sequel. I mean this sequel, MySQL. So I hate MySQL. I have to be honest. I really hate any kind of SQL database. If I can, I get avoid it. That's not entirely true because there are cases where SQL databases are very useful, but I think they are being overused. So because I hate MySQL, I obviously had to implement Game of Life in MySQL. How do we do that? And you know, I don't think that many people would want to start implementing this in MySQL. Why would you do that? But why not? So the way I'm going to represent my world is that I will have a population table, and I'm going to insert values into this population table. For each X and Y, I will have, like, or each row is going to be an X and Y, and I will just simply insert the coordinate pairs that are alive. Makes sense? It's like basically a list, if we are talking proper programming language lingo. Okay, so what do we do with that? Well, to do anything useful with that, I actually need a second table. It's not very clean. I would love to not have to do this, but yeah, it's simple. It's just offsets. It's the same what we saw with the deltas in the previous solution. I just listed all of the possible deltas to a neighbor. Okay, now that we have all of that, what we could do is that we could select from population offsets. This is the direct join, right? And I'm just going to select x plus dx and x y plus dy. Why do I do that? I do that because now I have all of the neighbors. I have created the list of all of the neighbors of the living cells. That's quite lovely. I could use that for something. So what I can use it for is I can just count how many times a coordinate pair shows up, group by those coordinate pairs, and what I get is basically the list of neighbors and also how many times it is a neighbor of something else. Cool. Okay, that's not enough. I actually need more. I need to know if that cell was alive, and I kind of lost that information, damn it. Okay, so could we somehow fix this? Well, one way to fix it is that I will just add a neighbor column to my table. And in that neighbor column, it's going to be always one except for this center cell. Okay? So when I use that, I can basically add one more sum, which is 1 minus neighbor. This is only going to be 1 for the center cell. And do a sum. And now I also have, is this specific cell, how many neighbors does this specific cell has, and also if it's alive or not. Cool. Okay. We are just one step away. Those of you who are not very good with SQL would probably put this into a subquery and then do a select from that subquery. Those of you who are fancy people, you can use a having clause. And it's done. That's all. We have implemented Game of Life in SQL. But there is a catch. Who knows what's the catch? Why is this not a complete implementation? And to really explain what I mean by complete implementation, someone has created a Turing machine inside of Game of Life. So we know that Game of Life, when we can run it for several iterations, is Turing complete. It's a machine. It's a computer on its own. But there is a catch with this SQL solution. Who knows what? It can only calculate one iteration. Once you calculate one iteration, we are stuck. We can't continue. Okay. So how can we fix that? And now this is the point where I start looking up features of SQL because I get obsessed about this. And it turns out that there is something called recursive in SQL, and you can write a recursive query that queries itself, which is really cool. And I'm just get super excited. I put everything into this recursive thing, and it doesn't work. Why it doesn't work? It doesn't work because aggregations and window functions are not allowed inside a recursion. That's the error message. And I'm like, huh, window functions, interesting. What are you talking about? I don't know what window functions are. So I go down this rabbit hole and start figuring out how this works. And then I eventually give up because MySQL can do this, but MySQL is not the only SQL. There is also PostgreSQL. And it turns out that if you go deep down into the rabbit hole, deep enough, you don't only find this really nice rabbit, but also this horrible piece of code that I'm not going to explain. But this is actually the Game of Life in PostgreSQL, and it is actually running for multiple generations. Moral of the story, I never knew you could have recursions in SQL. So I encourage all of you to read up on that, or window functions. There is one more interesting thing here, and that is, what I learned is that we can bring quite complex business logic in closer to data. We can run quite complex business logic on the server, which is cool. Fair warning. People can bring really complex logic inside the database, which isn't cool. Let me explain. So yes, it's nice because sometimes you have some really complex calculation that if you get all the data into your microservice, then it's going to take a long time to just transport all the data from the database. So it's really nice that you can do things on the server. The drawback is that if you do that, you lose the ability to debug. It's really hard to debug these complex queries. And also, in case you have to run this query a lot of the times, then what will happen is that you are putting stress on your database, and it's a lot harder to scale a database than it is to scale microservices. So use sparsingly. That's what I'm saying. It's really cool that you can do that with SQL, but don't overuse it because it can create some pain. All right, so finally, the third solution, or well, depending on where you look, the third interesting solution and the fourth total. Let's unleash the monster. How many of you have a GPU in your computer or laptop? Hopefully everyone, and I don't see enough hands. How many of you have ever written code for the GPU? Ah, that's like, I'm seeing more hands now than previous. That's weird. So, yeah. Almost every one of us has a GPU. Actually, we have a GPU in our phones now, but we rarely write code for it. Why? Well, it's pretty complicated, that's why. But just to bring home why this GPU is such an awesome tool. So here is a simple problem, adding two vectors, right? How would you do that with a CPU? Well, you would add the first two numbers in a for cycle, then go to the next number and add those two, and then the next one, and then the next one, and the next one, and so on. And it takes forever. But with a GPU, what the GPU does is that it has only one control unit, but it has 500 arithmetic units. So what it's going to do is that that one control unit is going to assign for each of these number pairs one arithmetic unit, and it will just add all of the numbers at once. Like, imagine the power that comes from this. That, like, the smallest GPUs have 500 arithmetic cores for a single control. But you have thousands of arithmetic cores on a modern GPU. And this is powerful. You can have enormous amounts of calculations in just one cycle. So how do we use that? And I mean, I used to do very different languages, one of which was C++, because I hated myself at the time. But nowadays I use JavaScript. And unfortunately, the only really supported language for GPUs is C++. You can use CUDA to code GPU code. But luckily, there is WebGL, and you can hack WebGL and force it to do calculations for you instead of rendering useless graphics. Okay, and there is a nice JavaScript library. It's called GPUJS. Very simple name, very straightforward. GPUJS, and you can use that so that you don't have to hack that much. The hack is hidden from you. Okay, so here is GPU.js, and we are going to create a kernel. A kernel is basically, think of it as a loop structure, but instead of looping through values, it's just going to do everything at once. And then here I have an n by n output. So this kernel, you have to say what size of matrix do you want as an output, and then for each cell of this, you will get a separate run of this function with the x and y values set through the thread dot x and y. That's it. That's really simple and straightforward interface, right? And now, for example, I could just add numbers. This is the number problem that I showed you a second ago. But if the word is a matrix, like in our very first uninteresting solution, then we can use GPU to calculate all of the cells, right? And here, it's not going to be like we are going to have an n by n world, but it's not going to be calculated for each cell one by one. It's just going to be calculated once in a single cycle, okay? So at the end, we need to return the new value, which should be 1 or 0, depending on whether or not the cell is alive. Warning, like, a lot of the things that are convenience features in JavaScript are not available inside of kernels. So you, for example, cannot define constants. That's why I have 1 and 0 there. And then we already know this rule, like count 3 equals 3 and count 2 equals 2, and it's alive, whatever. You can figure it out. And then we just do a count just like in the first solution. And then there is this is alive function, which is a little quirky because like the GPU really hates you if you are not careful with the indexing. You have to have a lot of these if statements there to make sure that you are not trying to ask for a value that it's not there. But that's it. And the interesting part about this, well, why I love this solution, is that it's incredibly powerful and it's incredibly fast. In fact, all of the solutions that I showed you today are so slow that you cannot practically run it in a browser. You would actually only get a few frames per second. With this one, you can generate full 4K quality images in real time at 100 or 200 FPS, depending on GPU, right? So this is a very, very powerful tool. And it's generally an untapped resource. So I already gave you a homework with looking up window functions, but this is my other homework. Like, play around with GPU.js. Because even if you don't run into a problem that is relevant, it's still very nice to know how to use it and to have that in the back of your mind that, if I have to calculate a lot of things at once, maybe a GPU is my tool. And also, like, GPU programming is addictive. It's so addictive. How many of you have been taking part in the Advent of Code? You know Advent of Code? Okay, so not enough people know Advent of Code. It's basically every December the 1st, there is this competition starting, and every day you get a simple problem that you need to solve as soon as possible and then submit the solution, and you collect points, and it's very exciting. And the problems start out really easy, and then they get increasingly hard. And in 1 year, I even decided to try and solve as many of those with GPU code, just so that I practice GPU programming. So GPU programming is very addictive. Fair warning, GPU programming is very addictive. And also painful to debug, because since it's a device, it's not going to give you the kind of really nice error messages that you hope for. Okay, so one more thing. These were the solutions that I wanted to share. But here's the thing that I also learned at code retreats. Whenever we had these code retreats, people were experimenting with different agile techniques, something that they heard at a conference. And at the end, in the retros, I often heard this excuse that, yeah, I learned so much today, but I would never have time to use this in my day job because we never finished the code here. And I was like, no, that's not the message that I want you to take away. We have the best practices so we can move fast. And if the people walk away with the message that if we do things right, then we are not going to move fast, that's the wrong message. So I wanted to create an event similar to code retreats that is more about learning how to actually move fast in practice. And that's how Lean Poker was born. So Lean Poker is this one-day workshop where people get together. Everyone gets a poker bot that is already playing poker. Every few seconds, your bot is going to make money or lose money. Not real money, by the way. Don't worry. These are just chips. But you are in a team of engineers who are trying to improve your poker bot. And you are trying to solve the problem of, like, you know, you just want to win. That's the point, right? And while you're there, you will learn how to actually apply all these strategies. Because we hear, like, I really loved Sven's talk this morning, the keynote speech, right? But how do you actually, like, I don't think that just hearing about processes and these complex things is enough. We actually have to try it. And the way to try it is if you have an environment where it's okay to fail, where it's where you don't, we don't have to care about the impediments of real life work, right? And you know, when we go on a Limpoker event, that's pure joy. That is developer joy, what you experience there. So I just wanted to mention this, that if you want, you can actually come to one of these events. I even brought some flyers. And everyone who can remember this code, heapcon30p, is going to get 30% off from their ticket if you buy one for the November event. And here I have a bit of you know, flyers. If you want to pick some up, then you can come here to the stage. And that's all. Thank you so much.